Okay, I think we can start. Can you hear me? Yes? Okay. So good morning, everybody, and welcome to the webinar series by the Center for Complexity and Biosystem of the University of Milan. First of all, we would like to thank you for your participation. And please, before starting, let me introduce some notes. Reminder to switch off your microphone during the seminar. If you have questions, please keep them till the end when we will open the discussion time. And however, if this question is urgent and short, you can type it in the chat and I will interrupt the speaker. But for a general question, keep it for the end. Lastly, we are recording the seminar that will be uploaded on our channels and YouTube afterwards, so you will have also the opportunity to watch again some parts if you wish. And now let's start. Today we have a very special talk from a member of our center, Maria Rita Fumagalli, who is a physicist. She has a PhD in complex systems for life science, and she's currently postdoc at the CNR Institute of Biophysics in Genova. Today, she will talk about a comparative analysis of metabolic and transcriptomic features of Notobranchius furzeri. Please, Maria, go ahead.
I will share the screen.
Yes.
Okay. Are you able to hear me? Okay. Thank you, Silvia, for the nice introduction. And yes, I'm a physicist, but I've always worked at the interface between physics and biology. And the aim of my research is to kind of build a bridge between these two sciences. So what I do usually is make modeling and data analysis in order to study system biology problems. And I'm really interested in evolution and also relationship between evolution and cancer features. What I will talk to you today about is this small fish that is Notobranchius furzeri. This is a fish who is living in Africa, and he's peculiar because he lives in a region where we have just two seasons, so a rainy season and a dry one. And of course, since he's a fish, he can live in water, and so he has a short time to lay the eggs. And during the dry season, the eggs will stay dormant. And until the next rainy season, when there is water, they will open up, the embryos will develop, the fish will live, and will leave new eggs. And all this process lasts about 12 to 40 weeks, so it's very short time. And this makes Notobranchius one of the short-lived fishing and vertebrates in Earth. And the relationship between lifetime and body mass is well known, and it has been studied for mammals especially. So it is known that there is a sort of scale between small animals that have short lifespan and large animals that live longer. What we did is to analyze data about fishes, and we plot here lifetime as a function of the weight for about 1,000 species. And as you can see in red, you can see the dots that are Notobranchius, different species, and these are outliers of the distribution. Very, very similar effect you can see for the grow rate, essentially. This is parameter K. So when you plot the grow rate as a function of the weight, again, Notobranchius will be outlier. And not only they are outliers here, but Notobranchius shows the hallmarks of aging. So it doesn't only lives for a short lifetime, but it gets old. And it means that we can observe weight loss and color loss and deformation of the bones. Sorry, let me move this away. Okay. so you can see better, sorry. So what we are interested about is to take gene expression during this aging process, and we consider three different tissues at five different time points for this fish. The different tissues are really different as a function and as a kind of aging process you would expect from them. While the five time points start from 5 weeks, that is sexual maturity, down to very aged fishes. And if you visualize the time points we are considering as a function of survival rate, you can see that they form quite a straight line, means that when a fish is at half of his lifespan, it has also a high chance to be dead. And this is not really usual. So there are, if you compare the same curve for Danioreo, that is zebrafish, that is nothing but a very famous fish model, you can see that the curve is more flat at the beginning, and the same data from Mus musculus shows that it gets older, slower. So what the data we are considering for all this work are five time points for each species and the three tissue we said before. And we can do a lot of work on these genes, and we can compare the different time points, the different tissues, we can make a gene ontologies analysis on that. But even when we pull everything together and we see a zero basic information, that is the percentage of the regulated genes in the three species in general, we see that Notobranchius has a larger fraction of the regulated genes. So it already has something different. And then what we ask is how these genes are distributed along the genome. And if you consider that these arrows are genes, it is well known that they are not uniform along the genome. And moreover, DNA is in a complex with proteins, so it's not really a linear structure. It's quite elaborated because it has to be compacted into chromosomes. And so we can ask how close are differential expressed genes one to the other. So if they are clustered, for example, here you have two genes that are upregulated close one to the other, and three genes that are downregulated that are also in a cluster, or they are random distributed along the genome. In order to do so, what we do is to take the distances between differential regulated genes, the experimental distribution, and compare them with a random model where we choose the genes from the genome at random. And then we ask, are they clustered? And we did this for each time point, as you can see in the heat map, for each tissue, for both upregulated and downregulated genes in the three species. So darker colors means low p-value, meaning that the distribution of the distance is very close to the random model, while lighter colors means low p-value, means that the genes are clustered. So if you do observe globally the three species, you would say that there is no clustering in Notobranchius, while there is in the other two species, even with some feature that depends on the tissue and on the time. And this information is related to the stability and the regulation of the genes and to the structure of the chromatin. In fact, gene transcription depends on the state of the chromatin and two main levels. So you can have methylation of the DNA, or you can have acetylation of the histones. And these two levels together makes open the chromatin so that transcription can be performed, or the chromatin is compact and transcription is avoided. So when we say that genes are clustered, differentially expressed genes are clustered, it means, for example, that there is a region of the chromatin that is closing and some other region that is opening in correspondence with upregulated and downregulated genes. So what we study is the genes that are regulating this process. First of all, the polycomb repressive complex. There are two complexes of this kind of proteins. One is PCR1 and PCR2, and they act together to methylate DNA. We go to our data and we looked at the expression of the two complexes of proteins inside the different tissue. And you can see clearly that there is a downregulation of one of the core components of PCR2 in notobranchius. And this strong downregulation is very early. So the first time point up here is already switched on off this gene. And we do not observe these things in the other two species. So there is some kind of downregulation, there is some dynamics, but it's less pronounced than in notobranchius. The second set of genes we can look at are those responsible for acetylation of histones. And a similar picture can be seen here. So we have notobranchius with larger fold changes. These are a lot of genes of these two classes of deacetylases and acetyltransferases. And the picture is quite complex because different classes of the genes perform different functions. What I want you to see here is just the intensity of the heat map. So darker colors means larger the deregulation. And again, there is a signature for this in notobranchius. So globally, we can say that these two information say that there is something going on at chromatin level, very dynamics in our fish. But then going back, we have to remember also that we are talking about a fish that is living for a very short time, and not only living, but developing. So it starts from one egg, it goes to die, and it has to also grow fast. And growing fast meaning that there should be some kind of particular signature for metabolism. But when you talk about metabolic genes, you should not study just how they are deregulated as single genes, because they are inside a metabolic network. So when you talk about metabolism, you think about an input, a set of reaction, intermediate compounds, and an output. And even in the more simplest pathway you can imagine for metabolism, there are a lot of feedback loops, double streets, and so on. And the global set of metabolic reaction of an organism is really, really complicated. So you cannot study metabolic genes just on their own. First of all, we compared the metabolic network of the three species, and they are very, very conserved. It means we can compare them. So we have that all the compounds, the reactions, and the enzymes are conserved, and we can study them together. There are a lot of pathways, metabolic pathways we can study. Here I just plotted the summary of these things because we have choose to compact information into 11 super pathways. And the shadow of the heat map indicates how many deregulated reactions there are. So we translate the information at gene level to reaction level. And from a reaction, we see how many pathways are deregulated. And once again, the picture is not, of course, straightforward, but you can see darker colors here. So the amount of reaction that are deregulated in notobranchius are larger. So not only at gene level, but also at reaction level. But once again, okay, we are observing a single reaction in a pathway. And taken as an example here, we have an input, and this is a chain of reaction that gives me an output. And some of them have enzymes that are upregulated, like here in green, or here, and some other that are downregulated. And then you have to ask yourself what happens from input to output. So, because for example, you have to take into account the shape of the pathway, because this gene that is switched off can be bypassed by an alternative way. And if the gene is upregulated here, the result is that output is upregulated. How do we insert this kind of information on gene deregulation and reaction deregulation in the actual pathway? We did use a method that is named flux balance analysis. Flux balance analysis is based on the idea that when you have a metabolic reaction, you can immediately translate them in equations, because you have something on one side that is consumed, something on the other side that is produced, and there are stoichiometric coefficients between the two. So we can translate directly these two reactions in these equations where we have consumed and produced. And if we do these things for all the possible reactions in our metabolic pathway, what we obtain is a stoichiometric matrix with the weight of the single component. And then you have something that is never produced, is just consumed, and there is something that is produced effectively. And everything has to be in balance because you cannot create something, right? So you just say that you have something that is produced at the end, and you equate everything to zero. And the idea is that actually solve a metabolic pathways is nothing but multiply a matrix for a vector of fluxes, that is how much information, how much energy is passed from one to the other, how fast a reaction is performed, and everything must go to zero. If you want to see in another way, you have a space of fluxes of each reaction, you put some constraints on them, and then you look for an optimal solution in this space. But then, this is okay if you work in general, but we are working with gene expression. And when gene expression change, the optimal of these things change. And it's also difficult to say, what does it mean at single gene expression in terms of flux? This is because you can imagine that there is an enzyme that is very, very low expressed, but is highly efficient. So the flux that is related to that enzyme would be high, while enzymes that are highly expressed but maybe very, very low efficient will give a flux that is lower. So we do suppose that fluxes of the network are proportional to gene expression, but these constants are unknown and they do really depend on the kind of enzyme you are considering. So what we want to do instead of working with typical flux balance analysis is to consider the ratio between the fluxes and the ratio between gene expression. This means that fall change in enzyme give us a relative change in the fluxes, and we can optimize our model in this way. The case that we studied here is glycolysis, that is the fundamental pathway. So it's something that is very conserved and common in all the species. And we consider just one direction glycolysis. So we delete the gluconeogenesis part. And we define a quantity for this pathway that is the efficiency of pyruvate production as a function of glucose input. This is even because we don't know how much glucose, and we don't care how much glucose the fish is eating. We just want to know how efficiently it does run glycolysis pathway. And if we go to measure for all the species this quantity as a function of time, we can see a very different picture. So in green, you have notobranchius efficiency, and you can see that especially in skin, it is increased early also in time. So there is an increase of glycolysis pathway efficiency, while zebrafish has completed the opposite trend. And also in brain, fluxes are almost constant, as you would expect somehow, because brain is more conserved for something. So concluding, we have shown that Notobranchius furzeri lifespan is associated with relevant changes in gene expression, but these changes in gene expression are not to be studied by their own, because they lead to changes in chromatin, and they are related to changes in chromatin, and there appears to be a peculiar chromatin dynamics in this fish compared to other species. And moreover, we show that the changes in gene expression can be translated into changes in the pathways and in the output of metabolic pathways network. And these are the people that work in this project. In particular, Fran made the flux balance analysis, and Simone helped with data analysis. And this is the paper that just came out yesterday. And thank you all.
Thank you, Maria.